period of magic pouring out of my brain. When I look back, I said, how did I do that? I'm not smart now like I was then. How did I think of those things that were so different, never been done that way before? And every project I worked on for Apple and anyone else was an A-plus solution. I never once thought, had what you'd call a failure back then. In startups since then, I did have a failure where I had an idea for a great product, but it had to meet certain price, speed, and battery life numbers that didn't make. The way I look at failure is every project I ever did in my life that was for fun. Building a little game, building a little sound maker. You know, back in high school we had driving simulators and I'd make something sounded like a police siren to fool everybody in the dark. Well, but every one of those projects, I learned a few little techniques of connecting things together, and over time I wanted to make them fewer and fewer parts than any other human would think of doing. But they weren't worth money, they weren't worth successful companies, but each time my brain improved and remembered it for the next project I did. You move forward, just like with mathematics, you start with one level of mathematics and move up through the levels. So those were kind of like steps on the way, they weren't real failures. Actually, you know, almost everything that I've taken on, I get an idea so clear in my head before I jump into it that I have a pretty good idea that I'll be able to complete it and make it work. I did take on one project, just an amazing, amazing example of motivation. We were here in Apple, all of our programs were on little cassette tapes. You'd have to read them in, it was horrible. You couldn't say, run a program, you couldn't click on an icon. And disks, if you had disks, you could do that. With college computers, you could do that. And I had never worked with disk hardware or software in my life, but Apple was going to be allowed into Las Vegas, the Consumer Electronics Show, along with Radio Shack and Commodore, to show off their computers. And we were going to go to Las Vegas, and I'd always wanted to see Las Vegas, the city of dreams, but only three marketing people were going to go from Apple. And I'm too shy to say, I'm a founder, take me. I would never demand that. So I raised my hand and I said, if we have a floppy disk, can we show it? I'd never worked with a disc in my life, and the show was 2 weeks away. Mike Marklar, marketing guy, said yes. And now I knew in the back of my head, if I can work for 2 weeks and develop this man-year project that gets a whole floppy disk where you can say, run a program, run a checkbook, and it runs the checkbook program, they'd have to take me to Vegas. I'd be the only one who knew how it worked. And I worked every day, Christmas Day, I worked New Year's Day, every single day, and got to the show, took a high school programmer with me, taught him how to play craps, and Randy Wigginton won $35. And I taught Steve Jobs how to play craps on that trip, showed off that disc, and it was four little $1 chips, eight little $1 chips, and all the other designs had 50 chips, including a big, huge, expensive, you know, $20 to $30 chip. And why was mine so, it was just so unique. I thought of a different architecture, but I got to a point where I didn't know when I wrote the date on the disc and it came back, how would I tell where the bytes start and stop? You got 10101110, where are the start and stop points? Every those little ones and zeros, and I didn't know if it was possible, but hit on magic and it worked. I found out later in life, sometimes you take on the impossible, you solve it, and sometimes you take on the impossible, and it really is impossible.
All right, here's the question.